The Honourable Member for Toronto Centre.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Monsieur le Président, je partagerai mon temps de parole avec la députée de Mississauga, Brampton South. Les libéraux partageons l'inquiétude de la population canadienne au sujet de la sécurité ferroviaire au Canada. À la suite de la tragédie de Lac Mégantic, le gouvernement avait promis de prendre des mesures afin d'assurer la sécurité et l'intégrité du réseau ferroviaire canadien. Mais dans les deux derniers mois, trois déraillements graves se sont produits uniquement en Ontario. En mars, un de ces trains qui transportait des matières dangereuses a brûlé pendant une fin de semaine complète. Dans ma circonscription de Toronto Centre, il y a deux chemins de fer voués notamment au transport du pétrole brut qui traversent des quartiers résidentiels. Les résidents et les organismes communautaires comme Safe Rail sont inquiets et veulent voir la mise en place de dispositifs de sécurité et de la réglementation pour les protéger des dangers potentiels. Mais la Direction de la sécurité ferroviaire du Transport Canada manque de personnel, de financement et de formation. À un moment où Transport Canada a beaucoup de chemin à rattraper, son budget a été amputé de 202 millions de dollars, 11% dans le budget principal des dépenses. Ces compressions font suite à un rapport cinglant du vérificateur général qui a souligné, entre autres, que le gouvernement n'a effectué que 26% des vérifications prévues et n'a pas vérifié Via Rail, malgré ses 4 millions de passagers par année. Le rapport a aussi révélé que le gouvernement ne dispose pas suffisamment d'inspecteurs et de vérificateurs du système pour effectuer les vérifications des fonctions de sûreté essentielles. Lorsque le porte-parole libéral a posé la question à la ministre en comité, en mars 2015, celle-ci a déclaré qu'une seule inspecteur supplémentaire avait été embauché, portant le nombre total d'inspecteurs à 117. Ce plus récent projet de loi n'est qu'un autre exemple d'une approche fragmentée en matière de sécurité ferroviaire de la part des conservateurs. Le Bureau de la sécurité des transports a affirmé en février que les nouvelles normes ferroviaires instaurées par les conservateurs ne vont pas assez loin. Et les accidents survenus récemment appuyant cette affirmation. Le BST a indiqué clairement qu'il fallait retirer immédiatement les vieux wagons citernes les moins sécuritaires des rails. Les échéanciers prévus par le gouvernement pour le retrait de ces wagons sont irréalistes et les conservateurs le savent. Le Canada a été unifié grâce au chemin de fer et nous sommes nombreux à vivre encore à proximité de ces mêmes voies ferrées qui ont fait ce pays. Il incombe au gouvernement d'assurer la sécurité des Canadiennes et des Canadiens qui empruntent les chemins de fer pour se déplacer, de celles et ceux qui vivent près de voies de ferrées, ainsi que la sécurité des employés des transporteurs ferroviaires. Mr. Speaker, how much time do I have left? 5 more minutes? Thank you very much. So, Mr. Speaker, I represent Toronto Centre, and this is a riding where rail safety is an issue of intense community concern. Last fall, together with the members from my colleagues, the members from Toronto Centre and the member from St. Paul, we held a town hall. We held it on a cold autumn night. It was Friday. 200 people showed up to discuss this issue. And for me, that was a real measure of how strongly the community feels about this issue. This is not some remote technical question for my constituents, for the people I have the privilege of representing in this House. This is something that people are concerned about every day, that people worry in a very real, very present way affects the safety of their families, the safety of their children. We are planning to hold another town hall meeting in April in a few weeks, simply because there was such intense community concern about this issue. So I cannot underscore too much, Mr. Speaker, for this House, how central this issue is and what priority we must accord it. You know, Mr. Speaker, something that we hear every day, that we heard again today in question period, is one of the threads that runs through this government's philosophy. And that is a point of view which, for me, feels like warmed over 1990s U.S. republicanism. It's a starve-the-beast philosophy, a philosophy that says the central responsibility of government is to cut taxes so that you can cut government services. And that really is the central ideological idea of the government. Now, I personally, as a Liberal, strongly disagree with that philosophy and that point of view. I think that it doesn't make sense for our economy and it doesn't make sense for our society. But I hope that in this House, one area where we can all agree, regardless of the party to which we belong, that government plays an essential role and that government cannot be underfunded, that regulators cannot be must be given the authority they need, that we cannot count on industry to regulate itself, is this crucial matter of rail safety, which touches on the safety, the personal safety of so many Canadian families. My concern, Mr. Speaker, is that Transports Canada Rail Safety Division is understaffed, underfunded, and undertrained. And it is a division which has been a victim of the revolving door of Conservative ministers, 5 ministers in 9 years. I would be remiss, Mr. Speaker, if I didn't point out that another essential aspect of the rail safety issue, to which one of the honourable members opposite has just alluded, in fact, is the fact that we are seeing far more in the past oil being transported by rail. That is a big part of the reason that rail safety has jumped so high up the agenda of the people who I represent in Toronto Centre. People know, even though the level of information given in a timely manner about what's being transported is low, but people appreciate that vastly increased amounts of crude oil are being shipped along our railway lines, and that has increased both the perception and the reality of the potential danger that this poses. And I must say, Mr. Speaker, that reality didn't happen by accident. The reality that so much oil is being transported by rail at great cost and posing a great potential public safety hazard is the fault of this Conservative government, which has failed to get built the pipelines that Canada's natural resource producers need to get our resources to market. And that failure is partly a failure of a relationship with Aboriginal people. It is partly a failure of relationships with the provinces. It is partly a failure of relationships with local communities. And it is, above all, a failure of diplomacy and building an effective, productive relationship with the United States, our most important neighbor, our most important trading partner. This is a failure which is of tremendous concern to the people I represent in Toronto Centre, because they feel quite rightly that it has put their communities in greater danger. But what is really astonishing to me, Mr. Speaker, it is a failure which has also, above all, caused problems for the Canadian economy as a whole. So in closing, Mr. Speaker, we do see some modest improvements in this bill, but we feel it doesn't go far enough. And what we would like to see above all is a comprehensive, effective strategy for transporting Canada's product, Canada's natural resources, getting them to market. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.